Good evening, dear IBPC members, past presidents, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the administrative board of the IBPC, I'd like to welcome all of you to this evening on VAT. The topic for today's discussion is impact analysis on trading, manufacturing, and real estate. Our guest speakers today are Ms. Nirav Shah, Mr. Ashwin Dedhia, and Mr. Anurag Chaturvedi, who will enlighten us about the industry-specific impact of value-added tax on the said sectors and if there are any new notifications from the tax authorities. To begin our session, let's invite our President, Madam Bindu Suresh Chettur, for her presidential address. Thank you.
My dear fellow members of Indian Business and Professional Council, Administrative Board members of Indian Business and Professional Council, learned speakers of the day, ladies and gentlemen, guests, a very good evening, namaskar, assalamu alaikum. On behalf of the Administrative Board of Indian Business and Professional Council, I invite you all to this third session of our VAT series. After a session of preparatory aspects, taxability concepts, today we are on the third session, going to listen about the impact of tax, VAT, on various businesses and also industries like real estate, like manufacturing units and trading, etc. There are many businesses which are out of the gamut of VAT, but there are so many businesses which are going to get subjected to this. And as I have reiterated in my former speech also, we are all living in a foreign country and we have to abide by the law of the land. So it's very important to see that we have to give utmost importance today for this particular session to see how this is going to impact our business. So many of the businesses have already done the online registration of VAT, but they do not know much about the impact. And also the learned speakers of the day, they will tell about the new amendments or whatever the new news about the VAT series. Apart from this, I would like to announce that we will be having the conclusive session on 12th. And as promised last time, we will be bringing the panel from our members, as well as we are trying to get somebody from the VAT authority as well. And I would like to take the pleasure of announcing on November 7th, there will be a breakfast meeting where we have got one of the most prominent and IT icon, Mr. Shri Ashok Sutta. And also, he is also the former president of CII. And on November 11th, we have another very good guest speaker who is also the former S.S. Mundra, who is the past RBI vice governor. So we will be also inviting the various banks for a session with him. It will be a very interesting session. I request all of you to be present to hear these coming events. Apart from this, one of the most major event which are awaiting for you is on the December 4th, we will be doing UAE National Day for the first time in the history of IBPC. This will be an event where we are going to honor our Emirati friends dignitaries. So I would request all of you to block the diaries and to make this event a very huge success. Coming back to our session tonight, our guest speakers would also enlighten us about the further updates and notifications. Once again, I invite you all for this very informative session, having a very pleasant evening ahead. Looking forward for all of you. Dr. Ahmed M. Hazanin will be present here during the question answer session in order to answer. He is a very experienced person who is owning AHG and is having a very vast experience, and thus failed also will be able to answer your queries. Thank you.
Now we will commence our session with our first presentation By Mr. Anurag Chaturvedi, who will speak on VAT impact for trading and retail business segment, followed by Mr. Nirav Shah, who will give us detailed insights on VAT impact on the real estate, contraction and construction segment, and which will be concluded by Mr. Ashwin Dedia, who will discuss about VAT in the manufacturing industry. This session will be followed by the Q&A session with our eminent panelists. Before we commence our session, I would like to make a small announcement on behalf of our very own Bharat Bhai Jisha, who would want to cordially invite you on a high tea at the India Club on Saturday, 11th November at 6 p.m. at the Crystal Lounge with eminent doctors who had come from India. And we will be sending circular regarding that. So the first 150 people who registered will be able to attend the session. The doctors from Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital, Mumbai. Thank you so much. And please do register as quickly as possible so that you can be invited for the event. Great. So we will commence the session with Mr. Anurag Chaturvedi.
Good evening. Today the session is about let's know how about the VAT itself. What is the VAT is all about? We have done various sessions in the series now, and most of us are now having a good understanding of the VAT. So today I'll not talk about much of the law side of things. Rather, I'll try to focus more on the practical aspect of the things. We have done various engagement in various industries, including trading and retail. So I'll try to address the point about what are the key transactions that we need to look into, how the transaction being treated, and what is the treatment in VAT for those particular transactions. So today is we're going to talk about trading, which is export and import, reverse charge mechanism, a little bit about that, and we'll talk about retail, what all the different scenarios in the retail and how the tax treatment for those particular transactions especially happens. So the impact on trading operations. Before we get into the transactions, let us understand what is the supplies all about. Because before we get into the import and export, let us understand what is the domestic and what is the export. So no movement of goods outside the UAE. If the goods manufactured here and sold within the UAE, that's considered to be a domestic supply. And if the goods is imported and supplied within the UAE, that is also considered to be supplied in UAE. And domestic supply is standard rated, so it will be charged at the standard rate. The example can be a goods manufactured or imported in the Abu Dhabi and sold to Dubai or any other Emirates, that's considered to be goods delivered and collected within the UAE territory and subject to standard rate. Export to outside the GCC, export to goods where the place of supply is still UAE. So if I'm exporting any goods to Russia or I'm exporting any goods to any other country other than GCC, that is considered to be export. Now when I say outside GCC, definitely there's something I'll talk about GCC movement as well. But export means when the goods shipped outside or transport outside the GCC territory. So if you see example here, goods is manufactured or imported in Dubai, and then it have been delivered and sent to outside UAE itself. So that's considered to be zero rated. We'll talk about the case number one, import in UAE. If the goods are import, the place of supply is UAE, the recipient account for the VAT under the reverse charge mechanism. So if I'm importing any goods, I have to account for the VAT under the reverse charge mechanism. I will touch base on what is a reverse charge, how does it work in subsequent slides. But there are certain exceptions to it. There are certain exceptions where the goods will be re-exported to another GCC state. We need to see about how the treatment will going to work it. So the first point is that if I import the goods and I keep within the UAE, it is considered to be domestic supply. It will be taxed at a standard rate. If I import the goods and re-export outside the GCC, it's considered to be export. When I import the goods and ship it within the GCC member state, there's a separate treatment to it. So this is an accounting treatment that happens when I import a goods within the UAE, how the reverse charge mechanism works basically. So the purchase account debit, which is an expense or inventory, so either I'm buying for inventory purpose and expense, that's get debit for 1,000 dirhams. Input VAT, reverse charge mechanism 50, supplier credit 1,000, and output VAT RCM 50. So eventually, reverse charge mechanism is basically like, you know, a contra entry. We're exactly having a no cash flow impact. It has a very limited cash flow. It has no cash flow impact. But why this reverse charge mechanism is in place when there's no impact? Why we really want to have this reverse charge? What is really meaning for it? The meaning behind this is to ensure that government understand and realize, and FTA want to know that what kind of transactions which is happening in UAE, which is not tax, which is tax at, you know, considered to be under reverse charge mechanism. They really want to track the movement of goods. So that is one of the reason. And reverse charge will be one of the section in your VAT return which will be disclosable, I mean, which you have to disclose. So if you see the net impact of the reverse charge, payable is nil. So imagine a situation where I'm importing goods and re-exporting again to Russia, to United States or UK itself. My ultimate return, I have to file the return. So I am a taxable person and I'm eligible, my turnover is taxable turnover and I have to file the return. Should my threshold exceed $100,000? But my return will gonna be nil. So I'll be having a VAT collectible and VAT payable. My net impact will gonna be zero. Now case two, goods imported to UAE and transferred to GCC. So if you see the situation here, where the goods are imported to UAE, released for consumption here, but intention is that these goods will be transferred to another GCC state. So let's take first scenario. I import a good from India as a supplier, registered supplier in UAE, and I re-export those goods to KSA. Now in that case, my reverse charge mechanism is not gonna work. I have to pay the duty in cash here at the first port of custom, first port of arrival here, which is UAE. I have to pay the duty in cash immediately. And now that duty is not reclaimable within the UAE. So what will happen in that situation? I have to raise a tax invoice with 5% VAT to the supplier, to my customer in Saudi Arabia, where exactly he'll be taking the input VAT credit. So the importer must pay the VAT without using the reverse charge mechanism and cannot recover this VAT. This VAT should be recoverable in the GCC state to which goods are transferred. So if you see here, import in UAE, 5% in cash, and recoverable at 5% in KSA. Now, let's take another scenario where I import the goods here and I cleared the goods within UAE and after 1 month I re-exported. What will happen in that situation? So in the first place, when I clear the goods within the UAE, I'm going to account for under reverse charge mechanism because I don't know whether the intention, I don't have intention, but at that point in time, I will account for under reverse charge mechanism because I'm not exporting it to GCC. But the moment I re-export to GCC, at that point in time, I have to repay the import VAT by treating the transfer as deemed supply subject to VAT. Now, deemed supply also considered to be when I'm transferring the goods to one of my branch in KSA or one of my subsidiary or one of my related entity in KSA, at that point in time, that is also subject to VAT as 5%, so I have to pay the duty in cash, which will be reclaimable back in Saudi Arabia. So the place of supply, goods supplied within the GCC. The export of goods, place of supply is other GCC state, which is KSA, provided the customer is registered for VAT. Now this is very, very important aspect. When we talk about VAT and when we talk about exports, it is very important for us to understand that the customer whom we are dealing with, is it registered supplier? If it is not registered supplier, my threshold, there are certain provisions in relation to that. But in case if it is registered supplier, this is gonna be the treatment. So the customer debit 1,000, sales credit 1,000. An invoice will be mentioned VAT under reverse charge. Now why it is so? Because the moment I ship my goods, which is manufactured here and produced here, and I ship those goods to KSA, now that supply is not considered to be export. Remember the first slide that I started with, I said export anything which is outside the GCC. So within the GCC, it's not considered to be export, it's considered to be outside the purview of the VAT for UAE. important aspect of that, you know, I'll take 5-10 minutes more just to cover up. Warranties, a lot of questions in relation to warranties, whether the warranties is basically taxable or not. When I'm shipping, when I'm charging my customers, is my warranty taxable? Warranties are considered to be inclusive in the price. So these are considered to be composite supplies when I'm selling a product. So if I'm selling a cell phones, the warranty, the default warranty of, you know, that comes with it is considered to be composite supply. However, if I'm doing any additional warranty, that is considered to be a taxable service in relation to that. So manufacturer retail warranty, no extra charge, TTL is composite and not subject to VAT. So when I'm repairing the mobile phones against the warranty, whatever the service charges and whatever the spare part that have been used in that is not subject to VAT. Extended warranty is subject to VAT is 100%, 5%. The supply of replacement of goods or spare part provided, they fall within the scope of the warranty, should not normally be supplied for VAT purposes. The charge by a business replacing goods under warranty to a manufacturer or entity which is funding the warranty is a charge for supply of reverse, which is subject to VAT. So if I'm providing a service to a warranty manufacturer, you know, that may be a case, let's say you buy a goods from one of the retailer here, and retailer has an agreement with third party to provide the service in that relation, so that service to the retailer is considered to be taxable service. Gifts and sample. Gifts and sample involve the disposal of business assets free of charge. They are considered to be a deemed supply. And you know, there's considered to be a certain value. There's considered to be certain value within the year, which may fall within the which is allowed. So let's say around 5,000 dirhams or maybe 2,500 dirhams or $1,000. That value will be clarified by executive regulations. But if my gifts in a year exceeds that threshold, it's considered deemed supply and is standard rated. Return of goods. Return of goods under the, you know, if I'm not charging anything in relation to that, it's considered to be, I can recover the VAT, output VAT, whatever charge in relation to that. So I'll miss telecom. Slightly profit margin. Business promotion schemes. So business promotion schemes take many forms such as voucher, discounts, loyalty programs. Generally, they are the rewards programs by a company to its customer frequently make purchases. Whether discount is granted, VAT should be accounted for on the discounted value. So if I'm giving 10%, 15% discounts, that the VAT is due on the net discounted value. You know, in UAE, we often see a lot of vouchers, discount vouchers are there. So when the voucher being sold, the gift voucher is sold, at that point in time, it's considered to be exchange, or, you know, the money is transforming its positions from cash to voucher. So it's not taxable at that point in time. The taxable event occurs when the voucher is redeemed. However, if you're selling a, you know, gift voucher of 100 for 90, or you're selling the goods, gift voucher for 100 worth of 100 for 110, the excess value is taxable. FOC goods. FOC goods are considered as composite supply and input VAT credit not due on FOC goods. So basically, a lot of FOC goods are there, especially retail industry. You get, you know, 1,000 items, with that, you get 200 items free. So basically, the input VAT, you cannot take the input VAT on those FOC items. But in retail, there's a lot of practice like that. When I get those goods, FOC goods, I sell them at normal price. So when you sell at the normal price, you can still sell and collect the VAT on that, but you cannot claim input VAT in relation to FOC goods. Sample goods. Vision often provides sample goods along in the normal course of business. The free sample of the product to individual for marketing purposes. They meet the definition of sample goods, again to be clarified by executive regulations, are the retailer has to reverse input VAT if the customer is charged for the product at the later date. So you can give the samples to the business and there's no VAT due on that. You have to ensure that, you know, on the invoice you mention it's a sample goods. Should you charge at later point in time, the VAT becomes due on those. Support. Now this is my last point before I hand over to Nirav. In UAE, you know, when we import goods for selling local price, there is a 3 or 5 key scenarios are there which we really want to address. You receive the volume threshold discount on the sales as well. Support on reduction against the price at later point in time, promotion to boost the sales, rebates. Now these considered, a lot of people call it rebate, a lot of people got, you know, various terms are used in retail industry to cater to this particular support. Now, important aspect is that moral of the story is that when I receive anything in relation to import, that is considered as a cashback to me. Cashback against the sales. So when I receive any consideration from an importer in relation to the supply that he made, is considered to be cashback, and it reduces my taxable value of purchase, and business must reduce the input tax credit taken before accordingly. So this is very, very important, that do I receive anything from the, you know, my importer, I need to reduce my import VAT. So this is going to be my supplier income from, you know, supplier, and input VAT reduction 50. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everybody, and thanks once again for giving us this opportunity to share one more session with you all. On this time, now that, as Anurag mentioned, that we have looked at a lot of concepts in detail, now we'll start looking at how we are going to apply in each of the different industries. So thankfully, he has covered a lot on the concepts and retail part of it. I'll be focusing on the real estate construction contracting part of the segment. And then, of course, my colleague Ashwin will take over you through the manufacturing segment. And then at the end, we'll take the questions with the panel, along with Dr. Ahmed, who is present with us today as well. It's very important sector for a UAE economy, real estate, and lots of businesses are involved directly, indirectly, and it depends also on this sector. If you look at the VAT law, there are two segments which are going to be very critical. One is real estate, other is going to be the financial services sector. Because both of this sector deal with part of the things which are exempt and other part which is essentially taxable. And therefore, you will have lots of issues on allocation of input credits, what is taxable, what is not taxable, what is exempt, what is standard rated, all of that. So we are going to try and look at some of these aspects today. Please bear in mind that some of the slides you will see will find repetitive, because we all have to discuss for each segment the place of supply rules and input credit rules and all of those. So you'll see some of those as a repetitive part. So when we come to real estate, again, any segment per se, there are five things: whether it is goods or service, what is the consideration, whether it takes place in the country or not, is it made by a taxable person or not, and is it in the course of your business or not. So this is the five tenet on which the VAT chargeability gets determined. So for any segment, again, you'll have to look at it from that perspective. Now when we look at real estate, there are two broad types. So there are real estate services which are related, and there are services which are not real estate services. And again, some of the guidance has been provided by FTA on what they consider to be real estate services and what they don't consider to be the real estate services. Provision of hotel accommodation, services of estate agent and real estate experts, services of architects, services related to construction work. So all of this are going to get covered within your taxable real estate supplies or services. And what are not real estate services are, of course, the provision or secondment of people and advice or information relating to land or property markets generally, not specific to any item. Again, we'll see a lot of examples now as to what is going to get covered, what is not going to get covered, and when, so that you become a little more clearer on applying a lot of these things. So as Anurag explained, what is the reverse charge? The reverse charge is basically a situation where VAT registered person imports services from a person outside or is not subject, and therefore he has to account for VAT in respect of those services which he has availed here. You know? So that's reverse charge. Anurag has taken it in a lot more detail, so I'm not going to explain it further. From a construction perspective, this is typically used for cross-border supplies where you want to relieve the non-resident supplier of services from any compliance locally. And therefore, you shift the onus on the local party who is receiving that service to carry out the compliance on their behalf. And therefore, purchaser or importer or user of that service will account for VAT and take it forward. So let's take a supply service, cross-border B2B supply. A Bahrain company is providing legal services to a UAE company in relation to a real estate located in UAE. So by default, if it is in relation to real estate located in UAE, it will become a service, import of service, and therefore the UAE company will account for it on a reverse charge basis and comply with the FTA requirements. Similarly, when it is a cross-border B2B supply by the Kuwait company, again UAE land related services, so it's not a legal service other than that. Similarly, because the building is in UAE and the recipient is also not in UAE, therefore the provider will have to necessarily register here and comply with VAT here in absence of recipient also being in UAE, because again it relates to a real estate in UAE. So as far as real estate services are concerned, wherever real estate is located, the place of supply will get attracted to that. So similarly, if you have inbound real estate services supplied by an India company, say it's an architect to a UAE company, architect services, again like we saw earlier, will be considered to have been rendered in UAE, and UAE company, because it's based here, will do the compliance in this case. And now we take an example where it's a lease and a case where landlord is outside the UAE. Here, because you are an owner of a real estate in UAE, if you are based outside, you will need to necessarily register yourself being a landlord here and take cognizance of take care of all the compliances in relation to VAT here. Again, time of supply and some specific example therewith. So, building material delivered to the customer on 1st February, invoices issued later, but as we saw earlier, once the delivery is made to the customer, the time of supply has occurred at that point in time, and therefore the taxable event will occur when the supply takes place and not when the invoices take place. In fact, just a corollary, that invoice also needs to be raised within 14 days of the taxable event. So you cannot raise invoice also on 21st. So one will need to be careful of that as well. As we saw earlier, if you receive payment earlier for the services, again the date of receipt of the payment will become the taxable event date and not the actual rendering of services later on. So this again one needs to factor in mind and plan accordingly. In case of ongoing construction work, each milestone, when you complete that milestone and start either receiving advance after certification from architect or whenever it becomes due, that point in time becomes the taxable event. And you need to accordingly comply with VAT at that progressive point in time, irrespective of when the final settlement happens or when final invoicing happens. In fact, a lot of that will need to change fundamentally going forward, that as you receive payment, you'll need to start issuing tax invoice also to comply with the law and file your returns accordingly. So those again are something that contracting businesses will need to very well factor. Again, there is pro forma invoice issued, then it gets approved by the architect, and then only the final amount is determined. So that process also one we need to look at, and when the actual taxable event happens, you will need to account for it and follow it up accordingly. Now we talk of little bit on the transition rules as well, that you have already ongoing construction contracts, you have already taken contracts right now. So whatever is something that you have invoiced in relation to work that has been carried on up to 1st January is not going to be within the scope of VAT. But whatever, even if you may have invoiced in advance, but if you actually render those services post 1st January, you will still be in the tax net, depending on the transition provisions. So one, we need to look at your contracts carefully, and also what services are actually performed at which point in time. And that will become critical also going forward to determine the taxable event point for each contracting company as well. So one is, of course, you need to look at your contracts very closely to see when the milestones are becoming due and whether that is a taxable event or not, when payments are becoming due and whether that is an event or not. And third, of course, is your clauses in the contract. Does it appropriately cover you for the tax point of view or not? And again, those may need to be re-looked at from that perspective as well. So typical challenges as we see from a real estate industry perspective are, of course, the long-term contracts, cash flow, unregistered subcontractors. So you have a lot of individual people who are doing a lot of small jobs on site, and how do you handle them? And you, so far you have been just making cash payments to them, or even a lot of local transporters who used to not register, have one or two delivery vans and used to do all this work, and you just paid them in cash. Now how do you go, going forward, what do you do with them? And how do you deal with it? Documentation and contracts, then your documentation, your accounting, and all of that will become more critical going forward. Transitional rules and certifications, particularly for construction contract, for contracting firms, where your architect certificates take longer time. What do you do in the meantime? Whether your payments are becoming due before that certification comes in, or is it only due after the certification comes in? So again, contracts and terms of contracts will become important there. And last, of course, is the input tax credit, which we'll delve on or we'll discuss in bit more detail at a later point. Right, so supply of land and real estate, we have three basic components. It is standard rated for lease or sale of commercial property, as we all know. It is zero rated for first supply or first lease of the residential building within the first 3 years of the completion. And it is exempt for the second lease or the sale of the residential property. So this is something that one needs to be very, very careful of. If you have a mixed project, and what do you do with it, and how do you allocate each one to which one? So you are, as I mentioned, you have a construction company, you are taking supplies from a building material supplier, he will obviously charge you a VAT, and you are in turn going to charge or sell your services to the developer and charge VAT thereon, and you are going to adjust the input credit against the output credit that you charge. That's normal scenario for all the contracting. So again, when do developer take a credit if he is not generating revenue in the initial phase? What is, whether he is able to register, and all those issues will be there. So typical example, he took 20,000 worth of building material. There was VAT charge of 1,000. He actually then supplied along with services for 30,000 to the developer. So he has charged the output VAT of 1,500, against which the input VAT of 1,000 will get adjusted and the net amount will get further paid. And therefore cash outflow for developer will be the total amount, but at the contracting company level will be the only the difference amount. What if it is exempt? So you are a residential landlord and you are a repairs and maintenance company. Being a repairs and maintenance company, you will charge VAT on your services. But being a landlord who is only in the residential segment is going to be in the exempt category and therefore is not going to be entitled to claim that input credit. And this becomes an additional cost for the landlord in such scenario. So again, the same example, repairs and maintenance company has charged 20,000. 1,000 is the VAT charge thereon. He'll collect it from the landlord. However, the landlord is not going to be able to adjust this at all. And this 1,000 will become an additional cost for the landlord. Lot of queries on this. Hotel accommodation. So the provision of hotel accommodation will be subject to VAT, whereas provision of residential accommodation is not subject to VAT, is exempt from VAT. Some more criteria they have provided. So what is residential? A building intended and designed for human occupation. It could be a person's principal place of residence, Residential accommodation for students or school pupils, residential accommodation for armed forces and police, and orphanage, nursing homes, rest homes, all of them gets covered within the segment. Any place that is not a building fixed to the ground and can be moved without being damaged. So a tent can also get covered there. Any building that is used as a hotel, motel, bed and breakfast establishment or hospital or the like. A service apartment for which services in addition to supply of accommodation is provided. Any building constructed or converted without lawful authority will fall in the straight away. So the supply of residential accommodation will only be exempt from VAT where the duration of the lease exceeds 6 months and the tenant of the property holds an Emirat ID. So any short term leases below 12 months or below 6 months will be taxable at the normal VAT rate, a standard VAT rate. Transfer of a going concern, of course, is outside the, is zero rated for VAT purposes. But again, from a real estate perspective, say it is a property rental business, it has to have a continuing lease contract, staff required to operate, and property required to operate the business, and contracts necessary to operate. All that gets transferred on an ongoing basis, then you will be able to claim it as a zero rated VAT transaction. Transitional rules, we mentioned earlier, where a contract is entered into prior to the effective date of the VAT law, VAT will become due on the supply taking place after the effective date. So again, terms of the contract, when is the taxable event happening, and all of that will become very, very critical to determine where the transitional provisions will apply in each of the cases. If the contract does not mention VAT, it will become a cost. The value of the supply will be treated as inclusive of VAT, and you will not be able to recover that separately. So if a company has a contract, so the contract is silent on VAT, then you will need to impute VAT into this, and therefore out of total consideration, 238 proportionately 5% will be computed as VAT on that. However, when contract mentions that the VAT is to be chargeable, then of course you charge 5% over and above that and take it forward. Early invoicing will, of course, if you invoice early or if you receive a payment early, that will become a taxable event and you will then be subject to do all the compliances at that point in time. So even if you do on a transitional provision basis, even if you do invoice early, if transfer of goods does not happen or if goods are placed in possession of the recipient of goods after the cutoff date, if completion of the assembly has happened after the cutoff date, or even custom statement is issued or custom accepts the supply of goods after the date, all of this will trigger the liability to be there for VAT perspective, even though you have completed the invoicing and the payment as well. So again, one needs to be careful about this. So like we mentioned that if you had a lease for the past year, but if it was expiring only in January, there's no problem. For the new lease, you start charging VAT going forward. If you have an overlapping period, then of course you will need to charge VAT for that proportionate period, which is falling after 1st January. So again, the terms of the contract and the time or duration of the contract will become critical. Proportionate charge will apply for any period post 1st January. Input tax apportionment is going to be a big issue for the sector, where within the same entity you have exempt as well as taxable activity. And therefore, ordinarily, if it is a business which is a taxable, a mixed and exempt category, the principle is that you need to calculate the recoverable portion of the mixed input by reference to ratio of the input tax that is relating to the taxable supply to the sum of input tax relating to taxable and exempt supplies both. So the standard provision that is there for apportionment of input tax is related to identifying the input tax which are paid for either a taxable supply or an exempt supply and total thereof. So you take that proportion and you are allowed to take that input tax credit. However, the issue with most of the time that we will be facing is that when you are receiving the service, it's for the composite project. And on what basis then do you say that the service that you received is either a taxable or exempt or mixed? So at the point of receipt of that input, are you able to allocate that in any of this straight away? And if you cannot do it through this mechanism, what are the other options that are available to you to allocate those input taxes? So if it is towards a mixed element at all, but you are not able, you are not certain that, okay, I am a landlord, I have in a building 15 or 20 commercial units and I have 55 residential units. Now I have a common supplier or common service provider who gives me repairs and maintenance for the whole building, who gives me security services again for the whole building. There is no demarcation. So I am paying a composite sum for that service provided for the building as a whole. So when I am paying that 20,000 for the repair and maintenance service and I am paying that 1,000, is that an input tax for the taxable supplies or is that an input tax for the exempt supply? So fundamentally, whether I am able to apply this principle at all in those cases, and therefore if I don't, I'm not able to apply this, what do I do? Do I have option of going back to other options? So the fundamental, the basic principle is that recoverable mixed input tax is the tax paid relating to taxable supplies divided by the sum of tax paid relating to taxable as well as exempt supplies. And we'll look at when to recover again is at the point when you will match it with the output. But more importantly, I wanted to focus more on how do you compute in case of partial exemption. So first step is the direct attribution. So if input tax is wholly attributable to the taxable supply, you recover it straight away. If it is wholly attributable to the exempt supplies, you are not allowed to recover it. But when it is not falling in any of this, what do I do? So my standard computation is total amount of input tax attributable to taxable supplies divided by the total amount of input tax attributable to taxable and exempt supplies. If I am not able to use that methodology, then the law provides that if standard method does not give rise to fair and reasonable result, a business may apply to use a special method. The list hereof is of those methods which may be used by one of the cases, financial services industry, but similar will apply to real estate. So one of the thing is output method or the transaction count method. So output method will be then in proration to your output supplies or output chargeable or exempt supplies that we have. So then in that event, if I have rented the entire building, then I will prorate it in the ratio of the total lease that I received for residential and total lease that I received for the commercial. However, the only issue as we see today is that if you want to apply any of the special method, we need to first go and apply to the FTA that this is the appropriate method for me. So please allow me to use this method rather than the standard method. And they have of course created certain. So this is output based method, which is simple, but it can also be easily distorted in some cases. So it may not be simple for all, but it may be simple in some cases, you know. Again, sectoral methods are also available, but that will only be prescribed when they are available. And transactional methods, so number of transactions that we do is also one of the options. So there are anti-avoidance measures which are in place in the law itself. which says that the use of any special method towards partial exemption is not guaranteed. One will need to first apply for that special method with FTA. You have to take the permission. Only after that is permitted, it will take effect from the next period. And it will be subject to verification by FTA whether it gives the proper result of the allocation or not. So again, there are four conditions attached to it. If it produces a fair and reasonable result given the circumstances of the taxpayer, the data used in calculation is verifiable by FTA. So it's not something that you can use on your conjectures, on your whims and fancies. It has to be something that you can evidence and justify. And if they can verify that, then they will allow you to use that. The method will be reviewed every 2 years. And immediately upon the method generating an improved recovery of more than 10% compared to its first use. And the method is subject to being overridden where it is obviously distorted in respect of any transaction or more generally. So we do see that from a sector point of view, this is going to be a bigger challenge for a lot of real estate owners who has composite assets, and also for a lot of incidental services that goes into making this possible. And it is accepted the permission for its use may be withdrawn by FTA at any point in time. These are all anti-avoidance measures which are in place. So thanks a lot. I have covered on the real estate and the construction segment to the extent possible. My colleague will take up for the manufacturing segment and then we'll come back for the Q&A. Thank you. Thank you for a patient hearing.
Good evening, everyone. We had been discussing since last couple of hours on to various business impacts across different segments. Manufacturing or assembly, compilation, transforming of a product purchased in one form to another form, all this is part of a segment or a process where there would be some VAT impact and we would just discuss or explore a few of such areas. There are a few slides which are having some repetitive aspects, and since we are already running short of time for the panel discussion where we can have a lot of interaction there, so I would just quickly run through few pointers more on identifying the place of supply and such things, where when do we really consider us as taxable. So whenever the supply is happening within the domestic scenario, within the domestic area, it is taxable in UAE. Whenever the same is happening outside the UAE segment, it will be taxed at zero rate or zero rated supplies. Now, these are the pointers which have already been covered by Anurag in detail. So I'll just try and take up few of the specific scenarios which would come up in areas other than the normal supplies. So from the basic perspective, the taxability would be either of these, okay, whenever the dates goods are moved or removed, or the date on which goods are made available to the customer, or the goods or the date on which the assembly is completed. Now from a manufacturer or from an assembly perspective, this becomes very important. Okay, when there are scenarios where I am sending the goods to a customer, so whenever I am supplying the goods to the customer under my supervision with my vehicle, it is the point at which he receives it, and that's the point of taxability. So many times, in case we are sending it to our warehouse and from there they are getting picked up or they are getting delivered, the taxability would come up at that point, not from the point where I am moving my goods from my factory to the warehouse. Same way, in case of we taking services, whenever the assembly is getting completed at our units, that is the point at which the taxability comes in, and hence input credit recoverability also will be coming up from that point. Same way, continuous supplies in case of manufacturing, when we are having a continuous contracts and so on, the same parameters which Anurag has mentioned earlier would come up, as well as something which has covered for contracting or the real estate, similar logics and similar flows will come up. The key factor, or the one of the most differential factor into the manufacturing units would come up, is the capital assets. Now, whenever we are installing or setting up a large plant or large setup, naturally there will be huge investment that goes up. And in case of VAT recovery for this or such investments is concerned, they have made very specific scenario or specific case where the capital asset scheme would be applicable only in cases of large value capital assets. And for that, the recovery of input tax that you are paying at one go would be available over the period of its economical useful life. Now, the capital asset scheme has been outlined and given out by the FTA, and that specifically mentions where the asset value is higher than 5 million, greater than 5 million, even only in such cases this scheme would apply. For all other assets, that indirectly means, or that means what? For all other assets which are having the investment below 5 million, you can take the input recovery immediately in the same financial year or same return periods. So only cases where your asset value crosses 5 million, this would be considered. Now in that also, there are two types of, or two segmentation that has been done. One is pertaining to real estate, or something which is building or part thereof, maybe the plant and such structure. And the second is all other elements other than building. So which would be your physical machinery, which may not be part of building, but just added up into the building later on, or computers or other accessories and so on. So in such case, the first case where it is building, the economic life is considered to be 10 years, and the depreciation means the input recovery of the VAT would be distributed over the period of 10 years. And in all other cases, it will be distributed over the period of 5 years. So you can recover your input VAT that you have paid in 5 installments or 20% in each year. Now this recovery is again subjected to some more further conditions. In a normal scenario, if the whole asset has been applied for taxable supplies, applied for use of a taxable supply, you would be able to get the full recovery in that same period. But generally it may happen that you might have set up a plant or a building and later the use has changed. The use has changed and there is some portion of the usage which gets attributed to non-taxable supplies or something which is exempted. In such scenarios, the ratio would be proportionate in that subsequent year in which the use has got changed, and you would be entitled for recovery of input credit only to that extent which was pertaining to taxable usage. So in year two, in case I have reduced my whole asset use from 100% to 80% only for taxable supplies and 20% is used for exempt supplies, in such cases 20% will be reduced as an input credit and I will get input credit of only 80% for that year. Beyond this, so effectively this is the broad calculation. Beyond this, there are a few other pointers that come up, and this is where particularly with VAT, one of the core elements that come up is all our expenses or part of our expenses can get transformed into incomes for us. And we have to be careful recording and accounting for the same. It is not just purchases, but also our expenses where input VAT or the VAT that has been paid can come back to us. So few of the elements or few of the pointers that we have to recall, remember and align to are like staff related expenses. There would be many staff related expenses that we would be doing and the VAT may be part of it. So how do we really record them? Instead of taking the invoices for that staff expenses in the name of staff, you need to take that taxable invoices in the name of the companies, and some of them would be available over here for recovery. Naturally, the regulations would define which of them would be available for recovery, because some of them still would be considered as consumption directly, but some would be considered as allowed for the purpose of business and that would become a recoverable one. Same way, visa, travel, recruitment and all such expenses. So visa generally would not carry VAT at all because it would be a sovereign services. Travel, when it comes to foreign travel, international travels, again VAT would not be part of it. But services pertaining to travel, like travel agencies, you pay some commissions to them or such things, they would also have VAT. Now, if for my employee travels that I'm paying, and particularly for the annual leave travels, all this also would have VAT into it, particularly for the travel agencies, services and so on. So this also can become a recoverable input. So if I record them rightly, I can still claim that input recovery around that. Same way recruitment charges paid to the placement agencies and so on would also have this facilitation. International travel for our staffs. So whenever the staff is traveling internationally for business purpose or some other scenarios there for conferences and so on, again, there would be some services which you would have coordinated from UAE itself, and few services you would have directly consumed over there. So services that you have directly ordered and consumed outside the geography naturally would not have VAT, but the services that you have done through some agency in UAE, they would also have VAT, and you should record for them separately. Because generally otherwise it would directly go into business promotion expense or some sales promotion expense or conference expenses without recording the VAT separately. So prefer to have that record keeping done properly so that that can become a recoverable value for you. Labor camp accommodation, again a slightly debatable discussion, but primarily in case you are putting across a labor camp and facilitation around it, yes, for all the other SSM services that come up, for the air conditioning, for the facilitations provided there, the divas charges and so on, all input VAT would be available to you as a business because it is for the purpose of business. And in case of labor camps, primarily it is still, there are two opinions still, let us wait for the regulation, but primarily it may be considered as residential and the exemption would be available for the leases around it. Then in case of machinery and capital asset related expenditures, there are a variety of other heads also under which the expenditure would go across beyond the depreciation. For depreciation or for the assets which are of large value, we have seen the difference or the way a treatment that has been assigned into the law. Beyond that, repairs and maintenance and all that would also and make you entitled for input VAT. Need to record it appropriately. Make sure you are getting the invoices on time, recording it on time, because again the time of supply server rules and all that would also be taken to be considered across for you. Installation of machinery, supply spares and consumables, all these are also entitled for business input VAT recovery because they are all pertaining to businesses. Then there are something which may not be seen directly looked at as a taxable supplies, but still they would be vatable supplies as a deemed supplies. And like scenarios like intercompany transactions, where there are transactions between your group entities, but now these two group entities have registered independently. So all the transactions within them would also become taxable and you need to record for them. Again, fair market value concept would also need to be taken care in case you are not charging them properly or at a reduced rate or extensively low rate or no rate at all. So that you need to take care while your record keeping or the transactional information exchange is concerned. Sale of scrap would attract VAT as if you are making a sales. So any sale of scrap, whenever you are making, you have to charge VAT onto it, and this VAT is your liability to the department, to the FTA. Same way, free samples or supplies, are they taxable? If I am giving free samples, would it be taxable? Yes, no. How many of you feel yes? Oh, lucky we are. So many people still saying yes. So our two sessions have been some value added. Yes, they would become taxable provided they are above a threshold. Now this threshold is yet to be defined across in the VAT regulations. But if the free samples or commercial gifts are beyond a threshold, that will become taxable supplies, though you are not going to charge for it. You are not going to add value to it. So they would be considered as deemed supplies and you will be required to account for VAT liability onto it. And same for commercial gifts also. Then other operational expenses, your lease rentals, because the lease rental would be for commercial property, naturally they will be taxable, and VAT would be part of your cost that you are going to bear or you are going to pay. Same way, insurance. Now in insurance, again, life insurance would not be taxable, but in case of health, in case of other property insurance, fire, burglary, and so on, other scenarios of insurance, all this will become taxable. And there would be VAT component in the insurance charges or premiums that you pay across. So this all, if you record them separately, still you would be entitled for that recovery of that particular VAT on top of it. Then in case of finance charges, naturally, yes, interest would be not part of VAT. It would be an exempted element. But all the bank charges, all the discounting, bill discounting charges and so on that we account for or pay for, they would also have VAT element into it. And utility bills like telephone, electricity, all this naturally would have VAT as they are a taxable supplies. So all these expenditures that we do as a business, they would all have some in VAT onto it, and this can become a recoverable VAT for you. So effectively they can reduce your liability to pay the VAT that you have collected across from the cycle, from your sales. Same way, printing stationery or other expenditures. In case of transportation services, yes, transportation services for supply, transportation within the UAE territory, within the state, would always be a taxable supply. But transportation, when it is international, when it is crossing the boundaries of a country, boundaries of a state, they would become exempt. And hence, you have to take note of it when you are doing from your own vehicle or when you are using some other services from some third party transport providers. Same way, loss in the production cycle, loss due to evaporation, whether we would lose the VAT also on top of it or no. Like say for example, I have purchased some material and I am converting it into that raw material into some semi-finished or a finished products. During this cycle, there is some loss which occurs as a process of manufacturing. Now, is VAT on this loss a loss for me, or it will be still recoverable by me? What's your view? How can I prove it? Do I need to prove it? Yes? No? Are we recording it separately? Yes. So whatever input tax I have paid, I am entitled to recover it. So this separate record keeping or this separate recording may not be required at all. So all this is also part of your input recovery, because tax is on value, not on your product movements or products per se. So you are not giving inventory records to anyone. You are not making inventory records being available or accessible. So effectively it is value, and this by default becomes automatically a recovery. So effective loss is reduced by 5% of the input tax that already you are claiming or paying while you are making the purchases. Same way for reimbursements, make sure all the reimbursement, whether it be employee reimbursement, whether it be third party payments done by a third party on your behalf, have invoices in your name. Because without a tax invoice in your name, you would not be entitled for input credit. So tax invoices have to be in the name of the person who is entitled to claim the input credit. So with this, let us have a panel discussion. I tried to cover up the time. So let's take up the panel discussion or the flow further. Yeah.
Before we start the Q&A session, I would like to invite to the session Dr. Ahmed Al Hassanain, President of ASG Chartered Accountants, Dubai and Egypt, who will join us as a guest panelist, who has a number of years of experience in practicing experience of VAT in the Egypt. So, sir, we would like to invite you, and he will join the other three speakers. Thank you.
See, many cases where the VAT is applicable, for example, say rent, if it is more than say 350,000, but landlord doesn't charge you the VAT, and maybe some other expenses also where the your supplier should have been registered but he is not registered and he has not charged the VAT. So are you liable for that? Because you mentioned something about that, Anurag.
Generally, like, you know, in various places, if the supplier is not registered in various countries, what happens that the owner shift from unregistered suppliers to the registered supplier? In case of UAE, if you're having commercial rent, so if he's not charging you the VAT, the owner shift from you. But this is not yet confirmed by executive regulations. We need to see what the stand FTA takes. But most of the countries have that particular provision that, you know, the owner shift from unregistered to the registered supplier, even within the UAE as well.
Gentlemen, thank you very much for taking us through the VAT discussions. My question is, you talked about GCC. Has it been clarified if you're doing trade with Bahrain or Kuwait and they're not getting onto the bandwagon, then will there be any change in it?
Ma'am, in case of GCC means the member state which is implementing the VAT. So at the moment, GCC means only
implementing
and UAE.
So it is specific to GCC,
yes.
Implementing
states.
Yeah? So if any state is not implementing, then this wouldn't apply.
Outside the GCC.
Then it is pure export.
The executive regulation for the law in Saudi Arabia,
yes.
They already had issued.
Yes.
So, and it mentioned in the executive regulation for Saudi Arabia, any country in GCC will be in the agreement, will be considered as a GCC country, and other countries will not be in the agreement of the VAT, it will be considered as a foreigner company.
The confusion is only with GCC, the word GCC, because there are some countries in the GCC who are not implementing.
They use GCC for the future, because
okay.
They believe that one day all the GCC countries will be joined in the VAT.
Right.
But till now, GCC in the law means Emirates and Saudi Arabia.
Okay. So, with the breaking news of this morning, you think this will still carry on 1st January 2018?
Pretty much, actually. Pretty much, too, you know, the as per the law of the land. And one thing very, very clear, you have to understand that no matter the government is postponing the things out there to another 3 months and 6 months, the situation is status quo is going to continue. We're going to be standing on the 6 months later as well and asking the same question. So the government understand the same situation, and that's why they are issuing so many circulars now and clarifications on very aspect of things. So first hand looks pretty confirmed.
Thank you.
My only question
we'll
is...
We take two more questions now.
With respect to what the gentleman inquired regarding, you know, reverse charge mechanism being applied on the imports. Supposing I import in the first quarter of the year 2018 and I have to calculate my VAT on the reverse charge under reverse charge mechanism, but I sell the goods after 6 months, so I will be able to claim the set off in the only after 6 months. Do you get my point? So I'll end up paying. Am I landing up paying the VAT in the first quarter?
Sir, actually, at the moment there is no condition circumventing that you have to pay, and there's a time bound limitation for selling those products. There is no time limit as such defined as per the law. So when you report the goods itself, you're going to account for under reverse charge mechanism. You are basically recorded the liability of input VAT and output VAT. So you you file the return as well.
I'm recording my liability for input VAT on my receipt of the material, which will be in the first quarter.
Yes.
Whereas my sale is going to take place in the subsequent quarter.
Yeah, but you see, in the first quarter itself, you have taken input VAT as well as output VAT. So now when you sell, you're going to collect the additional output VAT which you're supposed to pay. Which you're supposed to pay in that quarter itself.
Yeah, so set off I can claim only in the second quarter. In the first quarter, since I don't have a set off, I have to am I supposed to pay the VAT on the first quarter?
Set off is already done. In case of reverse charge, you're not only debiting input VAT, you're also crediting output VAT at the same time. So set off is already done of the VAT in the first return. That's why you're filing the nil return. If you will not do the setup in the first place, you will be supposed to pay the import VAT of 5%. So the setup has already happened when you receive the goods. Only when you sell the goods, you are collecting the additional VAT which you are supposed to pay when you sell in that particular return period.
Yes, I would like to add something. When you import or purchase any goods, you will pay the VAT. And the balance for the VAT will appear in the debit side in the balance sheet, like accounts receivable, for example, okay?
Anuragji, one more question on RCM, reverse charge mechanism. Whether it needs to be kept item wise, that is imported each product. Suppose I have a 9,000 items in my inventory, all are imported 100%, and I sell over a different period of time. So how I will keep the track of each individual item, or how it is? It will be input weight, output weight directly. And sorry, let me complain. So if it is only 100% import, no problem. But suppose I do local as well as import, then how I will be keeping the recording aspect of it? This is my question to you.
So actually, that's why if you remember when I was talking about RCM, I was mentioning and suggested that when you design your chart of account, when you are taking your financials, you should keep your input VAT and reverse charge input VAT and reverse charge output VAT separate. You know, that's very important. When you keep these separate, it's not required to be itemized that, you know, you mentioned the reverse charge against individual items. Rather, the suggestion and the practice is that reverse charge should be. I think the suggestion is that, you know, reverse charge VAT should be kept separately from the normal VAT. But you should not, it's not required, you know, to maintain by item wise an item, you know, you keep on tracking. Because reverse charge, the moment you receive, you take input and output set of complete done. When you sell the goods, you are collecting additional and paying to the government. That's the mechanism.
It's the same like current account in the bank. There is a debit and the credit. So you will have the current account. It will appear if is a balance is debit, will appear a debit. Same.
Thank you. One last question.
Yeah, my name is Surinder Sareen. My question is, there are 8 companies owned by the same owner, and all of them have registered separately. Now, there are a centralized unit which charges and does all the services to all the companies, for example, PRO services, centralized HR services, and they are issuing nominal debit notes to it. What is the impact of VAT in this?
If there is the same activity or the similar activity.
Same activity being charged to all the units. Okay. Is centralized. PRO services, for example, renewal of visas and incoming, Emirates card charges, etc., then centralized HR services also, and similarly other expenses also, and they are charging nominal debit notes to it.
If there is a relation between the companies, for example, this company makes service for the other company and make invoice for other companies?
Yes.
If there is like that, you can, and the owner, at least 50% for the same owner?
Owner is same, sir.
Okay, can be registered as a tax group.
No, they do not want to get registered as a group. There is their policy matter.
Sorry?
It is a policy matter. They do not want to get themselves registered as a group. They want to retain individual entity.
Okay, for the tax purpose can be tax group or can be registered each license separately. Okay, but take care because the related companies.
Sir, I repeat, it's a policy matter. They do not want to get themselves registered as a group with VAT authorities.
In that cases, VAT will be charged at standard rates.
At the moment when you charge the debit, you provide recharge all these expenses to these entities, it will be subject to standard rate at 5%.
And will it be charged as an input tax for the other party?
Yes.
It will be available.
So it will be nullified more or less?
Yes.
Thanking
you. You will recharge all these expenses to these entities via an invoice, tax invoice, and then they can claim it back.
Thanking you, yours faithfully.
But also there is something related when there is a two companies, related company, sister company or mother company, because the law about the speak too much about the fair market value. When the company, when the sister company, it will be, you know, the taxes people and the 80% from the taxes people here, an inspector is from Egypt. So I know where and how they, more than anyone. We know the people because we deal with them like 27 years. So I know how they work with too much doubtful for the client. So they will try to find somehow any cases, okay?
Thank you, Dr. Ahmed, for your vast experience, and it's a great honor that you are here with us. And thank you, Anurag, thank you, Mr. Nirav, and thank you, Mr. Ashwin, for being with us. And
and a great and insightful evening for us. And I would like to also acknowledge and thank all our sponsors and partners who have, because of that, our events are happening. I think we should definitely acknowledge that. Danube, NMC, UAE Exchange, Nikkei, Task, Bank of Baroda, IFCO, and our media partners, Gulf News.
The introduction of VAT in the UAE, I believe, is a good move by the GCC countries to diversify their revenues and also to balance their budgets. The law which has come has also been explained over a series of lectures by the relevant authorities, and it is made quite clear. Now, all that we are expecting is the regulations to come, and once this come very shortly, things will get clarified. Like in any new law, it takes time for the people to understand and to implement it. It will have its challenges, but this will be only in the initial phases of 3-6 months, and the system by itself will take care, and I'm sure that the people will be able to adapt to this new regulation within a year's time. And like all the matured economies of the world have adapted to VAT, I'm sure even the UAE will be able to implement this wonderful piece of legislation in a proper manner. And that's a good move, I think.
The introduction of VAT in the UAE and the GCC is a very strategic step taken by the governments. And I really appreciate the efforts that IBPC has put in to put together these seminars to help prepare the business community for 1st of January 2018. Thank you.
Hi, this is Venkatesh here. Today IBPC had a very good workshop on VAT, which is the hot topic in UAE. And the speakers have covered well on the real estate and other industry sectors. It is it's a need of the hour for the business and professional community to understand more on VAT. It will be helpful for the IBPC members to understand and get more clarity. And I wish they have many more workshops once the executive regulation is out, so the members are well prepared and get ready for a VAT which is new to UAE.
Hi, my name is Shailesh Chasani. I'm working as a finance controller in Goldline Group of Companies. This VAT presentation was very informative, and when they consider the specific industry like construction, manufacturing and trading, it was giving an in-depth analysis into the mechanism, how it's going to work. Particularly reverse mechanism and the accounting treatment is very useful. And the IBPC is doing a great job. I wish them all the best.
Hi, this was a very interesting session on VAT. We got the perspective of manufacturing, what is the effect in manufacturing, in real estate, as well as trading. What I particularly liked about today's session was the speakers seemed very confident about what they were saying, and they supplemented it with examples. I wish there was a little more time, because three speakers in a short span, they had to rush through their presentation. But overall, it was a very good presentation. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Thank you.
It was a wonderful time for us to understand the VAT is coming. And we are, being a trader in the logistics company, we are ready to face a VAT and embrace the VAT very happily, because we think that VAT would be going to stay here, and VAT is going to be give more systems and more the interest to the entire the business community. As we will have, definitely we'll have some certain issues initially, but as the days goes by, when all the trading fraternity learns the VAT system, that the then the VAT should be, I'm sure, will be much more better and much more broader. And we are sure that today's event was more informative, more interesting, and we are very happy to be to come back again for the session 3. And there were a lot of things to learn and to understand the VAT. So this would be more helpful to the dealing with the future. Thank you very much.
This was a very nicely conducted session on VAT. VAT is a hot topic right now in Dubai and in the UAE. Not only the UAE, in GCC. I think the speakers did a very good job in telling us about what VAT is, how it would impact our business. And despite not having the executive regulations, these kind of sessions conducted by the IBPC give us a lot of confidence in order to be ready for VAT and to make sure that we are compliant in every way possible. It's a wonderful initiative, and I would like to thank the IBPC board for having such kind of events for its members. Thank you.
Well, today's session was pretty informative, especially for the sectors like trading, manufacturing, retail. The presenters gave very good insight about how the calculation on the VAT will be, import tax, output tax, as well as the claims, recovery, reverse charge mechanism, followed by the panel discussion wherein they took the questions from the audience. And these questions really gave the insight to all the people around to understand what way the different situations can be tackled with. So I'm sure these sessions will definitely be useful to the entire IBPC community and, yeah, value add to our VAT calculations.